Please welcome Rachel Johnson. Yes, yes. Welcome.
Thank you.
Brexit is a big part of your job because you are in politics, you are in journalism, and of course you have your brother. When this is over,
is it going to be over?
Sometime in the future.
10 years, 50 years?
Yeah, perhaps, but I mean, it has divided Britain in a way, and it has also divided British families, and yeah. and your yeah. family is really an example. It's a microcosmos.
I know.
In a way.
I know. Yes, I mean, it has divided the family, but mainly into members who think that Brexit is a shit idea and those who think it's a really shit idea. Sorry, am I allowed to say that?
Yes, here in the... you're in a free country now.
But, you know, yes, it has, and it's well, it's divided us all emotionally because we love our brother. I love Boris, who I don't call Boris, by the way. I call him Alexander or Al. Like, his close family call him Al.
How come he changed his name?
Because, OK, the story is when he was at Eton, which is, this most famous public, i.e. private school in the whole world.
Yeah.
He was, we lived in Brussels, and so he had his passport on lying around his room. All the boys have their own rooms. And some other boys broke into his room and, like, were trashing the room, and they found the passport. They discovered his name was Alexander Boris de Feffel Johnson. So they defaced his passport, right? So they wrote over de Feffel de PP. You know, like, that's a, by the way, you're exclusive for tonight.
I see.
Anyway, so after that, they discovered he was called Boris. And you know, in English boarding schools, they're always looking for things to tease other yeah. kids about, to rub the corners off, we say. You know, you go to school and yeah. your parents have loved you and you've had everything and you have a lovely duvet and you have hot chocolate. And then you go to English boarding school and it's beating and early morning Greek. And rugby and...
Was it like that for you as well?
Yeah, totally. And I was the first girl at an English boys' boarding school, so I really know.
But before that, you travelled a lot, right?
We did,
I mean,
yeah.
you all moved around a lot.
Yeah, the family was really peripatetic. We grew up in Washington, in New York, and in Brussels.
But I mean, because there's your dad and your mum, they're both...
Alive.
Alive, yes, but they yep. are on Boris' side, right? In the Brexit question.
Yes. No. It's complicated, really complicated. My father led a campaign for environmentalists for Europe yeah. in the run-up to the vote on June the 23rd. He was a passionate pro-European. He spent his entire life working for European institutions, yeah. the European Parliament, the Commission. And to do good things, you know, to introduce the Habitats Directive, the Waste Directive, mm. so that we have clean air and, you know, mammals have clean environments. So
today, where is he today?
Well, you'll have to ask him.
I will.
I think listen, this is what I was getting to. Nothing, that Brexit is anything but a bad idea. Oh, thank you.
But how is that? When you're all together, do you have this like discussions? Because you see each other,
you
right?
You can't.
It's like
you can't talk about it, honestly.
So what are the rules then?
No Brexit at mealtimes. None. No.
So you talk about the weather or what is it?
You say things like very nice crunchy roast potatoes and so have you seen The Joker or, you know, who's watching Succession? You know, this sort of thing, like normal families.
So have you ever had the great discussion with your brother?
Of course I have, yeah. You know, I spent a whole day trying to persuade him not to go for the vote leave side before the referendum, and I failed.
You have another brother also. He was in the government as well.
He was. He resigned from the cabinet this issue. Yeah.
Are you all talking? Are you all...
My brother's been really busy the last 3 weeks. Yeah. He's sorting it out. He wants to get it done. I see this bit as, like, I don't know, 1,000 metres of hurdles. And if we get the withdrawal agreement bill, known as the WAB, over the line, that's probably only the first hurdle in 100, 200 hurdles.
You had this culture in the family, I suspect, that you discussed things.
That's an interesting question.
Because you're a political family.
My father sent us to boarding school really soon because he said that parenting was too important to be left to parents. And so he said it was much easier if you got the kids and you sent them to boarding school in another country. So that's what he did to all of us. But before that, we went to the European school in Brussels. And we were in the English section, the English national section there, and we fought with the Danes and the Germans and the Swedes in their different sections. We were educated in the European system.
Were you and your brothers competitive?
Yes.
Was there a competitive culture?
Yes.
Who would win?
Well, for example, I'll tell you a story. I was once playing ping pong with the Prime Minister, and he lost 1 point against me, and he was so angry he kicked the wall and he broke his toe.
So that's yeah. The kind of loser is.
He's not a good loser.
He's not a good
but
loser.
But that's why he's won, you know, because, you know, the spoils go to the person who wants them most.
Probably, yes, but where does this... I mean, he can obviously stand a lot of pressure.
Yeah, and I agree. I mean, I couldn't do it, his job for 5 minutes. I mean, I think what the essential qualities of being a good prime minister are to have incredible stamina, incredible energy, incredible tolerance for stress, and to thrive on very little sleep. And if you read the 3-volume biography of Mrs. Thatcher, he has those Thatcherite qualities as well.
You say Thatcher. Looking at the family per se, I would say it's like a British Kennedy family. Or...
You're very kind, but some people say we're the pound shop Trumps. I mean, my father would love it to be the Kennedys, yeah. Obviously, but... Oh.
Yeah, but I was getting to that as well, you know.
Am I a banker?
Because seen from abroad, it's all often described as some kind of political brothers, your brother and Donald Trump. They are some kind of similar characters on the political world scene.
Well, I heard somebody told me... Well, you remember, of course, well, Donald Trump... tweeted, or he said, oh, they like him over there, they call him Britain Trump. But then when I was in Paris the other day, I didn't know that he was called Le Petit Trump. Trump, is that, you know.
But can you then be insulted on his behalf?
Yes, I mean, it's really
hard. Or does it make you proud? Do you think it's...
I'm incredibly proud that he's achieved his lifetime ambition. I hate it when I see him being shouted at and... you know, in the street, or people being rude about him, because I care about him as a sibling. You know, it hurts me, I can't explain it. It hurts me in my, you know, soul. But I don't like the politics of what's going on either, so I sort of, every day is like a sort of schizophrenic nightmare.
But you said a lifetime ambition. Was it... when was the first time you realised this was his lifetime ambition?
When he was about 4 years old, he told a family friend he wanted... whether he was asked, what would you like to be when you grew up? And he said, world king.
World
he
king.
Was 4 years old, apparently.
Would you say he had the support of his family all the way?
Sure, yeah. I mean, definitely his parents. Yeah.
So
there are 4 of us, you see, and I think if you're the oldest of 4 and very tight family and very close together in age, I'm only 14 months younger than him, and then I have a brother, Leo, who's 2 years younger than me, and then there's Joe, who's like a little bit younger. I think, you know, he felt he had to move very fast and break things to do what he wanted to do, because everyone else was chasing.
At one point, you decided not only to be to be a Remainer, as you obviously are, but you decided to actually go for a seat in the European Parliament.
I know.
For the Remainers, I wonder how did you tell your brother that?
There's always been we've always had a principle in the family that everybody has to be free, you know, to have their own sovereignty, and nobody can be controlled by somebody else just because they're older or more powerful.
That's why you can sit here tonight.
Yeah, of course. Everybody has to be free. And even if he doesn't like it, he has to accept that he's free, I'm free, everyone is free. And we, you know, we have to pay the consequences if we say things that actually undermine him or are unfair. But apart from that, I think politically we have to be able to express ourselves.
But still, it's a difficult phone call to take, isn't it?
I texted him. I just got a text back saying, good luck. Which, in fact, I really needed because I didn't make it.
It's a brutal environment in Britain around this.
Really tough. It's really tough. There's so much unhappiness and so much tension and boredom. We're so bored. I mean, I really sometimes feel if there was another referendum, okay, instead of saying the Brexit lot will say, tell them again, I would say my pitch would be make it stop. Okay, if you could be the party which would tell the entire country, if you voted for us, it would stop. And actually, that would be to stay in the EU, because then nothing would have to change. We wouldn't have to talk about trade for the next 20 years. The leaders of the Brexit lot and the government have stopped saying anything about what's going to be good after we leave the EU. All they say is the people have spoken, Parliament has got to do what the people said 3.5 years ago, as if democracy stopped and was frozen like in amber. And for one night only, that was democracy in this country.
Tell me.
Thank you.
How do you like it in number 10? How do you think it is there? I mean, I've never been there, and most people haven't.
You know something? I haven't been since he's been Prime Minister.
You haven't been there? So he hasn't invited you?
No. I'm just being honest. I'm a very honest person. I have been to the country place, which is very nice. Chequers.
So you've been there?
I've been there, yeah.
Okay, so it's not that they don't want you in this...
you'll have to ask
this
him.
Wonderful
you'll
world
have to get the Prime Minister and ask him. But he's been so busy. And also, if I went into number 10, there's all the...
Exactly.
Not for me, but for everybody who goes in and out. But there's a back entrance, you know. You can go in through the Cabinet Office at the back.
Do you think that in 1 year, this time next year... Mm. Do you think you're still the Prime Minister's sister?
I think, yes, I think probably. I think the country is very behind the Prime Minister. And I think the country is unbelievably fatigued by this. Let's say I want to go and move to Paris and work in Paris. I can't now. You know, so no wonder the Prime Minister says Britain's going to be the greatest place on earth. Well, that's the only place that I'm going to be allowed to be. So bloody better be.
Rachel, it's wonderful to have you on the show.
Lovely.
We're going to have another guest on, OK?
Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel Johnson.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.